There are just two factors that I want to add. One is transactional sex. We have been talking about sex for grades in the universities. Unfortunately, in the communities, we have the phenomenon of sex for food, sex for sanitary pads, sex for other basic needs of adolescent girls. Unfortunately, we have not brought the narrative to a national discourse for the policymakers to listen and take the necessary corrective action. I say sex for food because when you go to some of the communities, there is a hunger gap within a certain period where parents are not able to provide for the adolescent girls. And so they engage in transactional sex. Sex sometimes just to get food and eat along the day. It's heartbreaking, but that's a reality in some of them. And this is evidenced by the Ghana Demographic and Health Survey 2014, saying that the Upper East is one of the areas with the highest rates of transactional sex. So we need to put this in context and address this inequalities within our community. That's exposing this. The other issue is around access to contraceptives. And we are talking about 5.5 million of adolescents in Ghana urgently needing contraceptives and not having access to it. This is the stark reality that we are facing. Another issue is the fact that some of our health facilities are not adolescent friendly. So when you are an adolescent and you want to go and access these services, you are criminalized, you don't feel comfortable. So a recent report commissioned by UNICEF, known as the U report, indicates that 43% of people cite adolescent sites, privacy and friendliness as the reason why they do not go, they will not to choose a particular health facility. Unfortunately, they are not choosing these health facilities. So we need to really look into the local context. What are the specific local contexts that are drivers? And then the other thing Dina mentioned is that we need to decriminalize the subject matter. We know that sex is a taboo topic. And so the adolescent people, they engage in it anyway. Young girls as age as 10 years, they are exploring, but they don't have a go-to area to get authentic information. So for me, I think we need to bring back the debate of age-appropriate comprehensive sexuality education. If we do that, we're able to go to our imams, we're able to go to our pastors, we're able to go to our traditional authorities and open up and let them create an enabling environment where young people can passionately discuss this issue as long as it's age appropriate. People are concerned about the fact that it's against our culture, it's immoral, and that young people keep getting pregnant. When are we going to stop? So we need to have a serious debate around age-appropriate comprehensive sexuality education within our communities and with the necessary stakeholders so that they can become champions and open up and be receptive to adolescents so that the adolescent can be able to voice and raise their concerns before them. They should be comfortable raising their sexuality issues, understanding their bodies before anybody. And if they are not able to do that in certain contexts, they would have access to the wrong information. And unfortunately, this situation will continue.